All right, I think we're ready to get started. So great, thank you. I appreciate everyone's attendance. Again, the topic today will be transcriptome annotation, RNA-Seq analysis, and functional insights into the Cactus root development. So if we could just, I'll go to the next slide. So again, we'll do some basic introductions. We have a case study, it should take about 30 minutes, and we'll do a use case introduction, show some analysis, and then we'll just do some conclusions and follow up with a summary. And of course, most importantly, your questions about the webinar. Presenting today is Marta Matvienko. She's a bioinformatics specialist. She's trained in plant molecular biology. She's been involved in genomics since 1999, and she's been a collaborator with us for the last 5 years. Myself, Steve Montebianco, I'm leading the North American business development effort. And any questions post-webinar about more information about Blast2GO, you'll have my contact information, you can respond to me. So just from a logistics standpoint, if you have any questions or comments, there's actually an area on the webinar for questions, it'd be great to use that. And we'll either try to address them during the presentation, and we have on the line also our staff of technical experts. So if there's features, functions, we can not only cover the research part, but also we can cover the technical piece about Blast2GO. And again, if you guys experience any difficulties, feel free to text or call me at that cell phone number. It'd be great. I guess we're controlling mutes, so that's one thing you don't have to worry about today. So just to give you background, Blast2GO, we are a functional genomics platform. I see we've had 30 or 40% users here. We're a very user-friendly desktop application. We've been around since over 10 years, and we're known for our functional annotation feature, widely used for non-model organisms, and the developer has been BioBam Bioinformatics, is actually the developer of the product. And just to walk through some features, and it's be interesting, you'll see actually real-time a case study of how both the genome characterization, and for those of you who've known Blast2GO, the genome browser is a feature that you'll find very interesting. We've added RNA-Seq, functional annotation, interpretation, as well as biological insights. So if you follow this workflow, you'll actually see how Martha has used the tool to develop better biological insights on her research. And with that, I'll hand it over to Martha. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Steve. Yeah. So my name is Marta Matvienko. Good day, everyone. And I will go over the scientific and technical part of this webinar. I will not be covering all tools which are available in Blast2GO. I will cover just some of them, which we used for this particular study. So in our research, we face the problem of finding genes and functions involved in primary root development in a Cactaceous species. And this species we are studying is a non-model species and does not have a good genomic reference. We also didn't have freely available bioinformatic tools that are easy to use and would allow us for quality to annotate, to obtain the quality annotation, quality assembly. So as a result of these deficiencies, we would not be able to proceed to functional analysis until we have some basic knowledge about our organism and also some tools that would allow us to create this knowledge. So we decided to sequence and assemble transcriptome and annotate and analyze it using Blast2GO. So in this presentation, you're going to hear about root development of large Mexican cactus species. The name is Pajicerius springlei. The fruit of this cactus is an important food for some tribes. The plant flesh contains alkaloids. And this species, along with many other cactaceous species, is very well adapted to severe droughts. To understand what we wanted to do, we wanted to understand the molecular mechanisms of this adaptability. And for that, my colleagues and I, we studied primary root development of this species. The lead investigator on this project is Svetlana Shishkova. She is at the Institute of Biotechnology at UNAM in Mexico. What you see here an actual specimen, fruit collection, and you see the roots here, the root tips here before and after differentiation. I will talk more about it on the next slide. So in our earlier works, it was shown that cactaceous species, that primary root development in cactaceous species exhibits determinant growth. What it means? It means that root tip grows for a very short time only. In some species, just for a couple of days, and other species, maybe for 7-9 days. When you see actual growth of root tip, but after that time, after this time passes, the root tip stops completely. The development of root tip stops completely, and now you see this fully differentiated root tip, heavily covered by root hairs. The meristem completely exhausts. Everything is differentiated here. So our project objective is identification of the genes and functions involved in apical meristem exhaustion and the determinant root growth. So the challenges we faced is that there are no assembled reference genome. There is one very fragmented assembly now in the gene bank, but it's not much of use for functional research. And there is also no AST resources for this species. So we decided to create our own transcriptome assembly and use it for comparative expression analysis and for identification of functional changes in root development. And this is entire project summary. So basically with all the steps I'm going to cover today, we started from transcriptome assembly. We used Illumina sequencing. We created RNA-Seq libraries. And after the De-Novo assembly, we obtained over 49,000 transcriptome contigs. And with the longest contig over 14 kilobases. The next step was functional annotation of transcriptome. We used Blast2GO to compare sequences using Blast, maps the results, and then assigns the gene ontology terms, and sometimes just descriptions. This way, we were able to annotate over 30,000 of our contigs to some degree. The next step was comparative expression using RNA-Seq data. So for the purpose of this presentation, I run RNA-Seq and Blast2GO. It maps reads to transcripts in Blast2GO cloud. And then for expression analysis, I use pairwise differential expression analysis, which I'm going to present here. So this way we were able to identify differentially expressed transcripts that are up or down regulated during primary root development. And in the last part, I will go over the functional changes during development. So the same program provides enrichment analysis tools for statistical assessment of annotation differences between two sets of sequences. So I will show you the functional gene categories that were enriched, that are enriched or depleted during the primary root development. So let's start step by step what we did here. The transcriptome assembly. So we created six RNA-Seq libraries, four of them from indeterminate tissue and two from terminal tissue. And in total, we sequenced almost 280 million, we obtained over 280 million reads. They were all paired-based reads, they were all paired reads, and the length is 100 base pairs. Per sample, around 40 million reads we had on average per sample of filtered reads. And then we submitted all of them to De-Novo assembly. At the time, we were using CLC Genomics Workbench for De-Novo assembly. In the latest version of Blast2GO, you also will find the De-Novo assembler. Trinity was incorporated in the latest version, so you might want to try to use Trinity to create such an assembly. So average, as I already said before, so our total number of contigs we obtained, for which were over 400 nucleotides, were over 49,000 contigs with a total assembly length of 53 megabases. and average length over 1 kilobase. The longest is 14.5 kilobases. So it was a pretty good assembly we created here. So let's go to the next slide. So the next step for us would be the annotation of transcriptomes. And since I'm involved with genomics for quite a while and was doing this kind of work for many years already, early on when we've been working in early 2000s, what we've been doing, we've been using simply BLAST. So, and if someone has just a few contigs they need to annotate, it's relatively easy, can be done using just BLAST at NCBI, and then descriptions can be assigned manually. And that's what we did early on. And then when we started to work with large sets of sequences, we've been blasting them at NCBI in batch, and then we created some scripts which we used to parse those data, and then another set of scripts to insert those descriptions into the sequencing file. So custom scripts can do some work, not to the extent to which I'm going to present here, but they can be also used to do this. So what are our current choices? We could use Blast2Go, and that's what we used for this work. So Blast2Go, as it's probably clear now, it's a commercial tool. It's very user-friendly, and it's supported for all major platforms, operating systems for Windows, Mac, and Linux. I also decided to search and see what else can be used now. And I found a couple of pipelines which are public and which probably can be used by some people advanced in bioinformatics. There are pipelines called Trinitate and Anacrypt. Both of them are command line based. They are free, but they will require a configuration of multiple tools. So it is not click and go. You will have to know what to do and how to combine those tools, how to find the parameters. And those tools are Linux based only. So and this is what we did here. We used Blast2Go, so we imported our contigs into Blast2Go. What you see here on the left are all the contigs, and on the right in this window you can see that I just opened one of the contigs, the longest contig here. So you would be working using Blast2Go, you will be working in a nice graphical interface. So Blast2Go compares sequences using BLAST, maps the results to functionally annotated proteins, and then assigns the gene ontology terms. So there are a couple of ways to do it in Blast2Go. First of all, right now there are already BLAST pre-built annotation workflow, and what I was using lately. Early on, I did run all the tools separately. It means that what you start with blasting your contigs in Blast2Go cloud, and then they will go through mapping, through annotation. At the same time, the same contigs also will go, Interpro will be run on them, and then annotations from mapping and from Interpro will be merged. And number of graphs and charts will be also created by this pipeline. Let's look into a little bit more detail into these annotation steps. So the annotation is happening when users are running Blast2Go Pro. All the annotation is happening in dedicated computer cloud. And then gene ontology mapping retrieves gene ontology terms associated with the hits obtained by the BLAST search. And then annotation step selects the best gene ontology terms from the gene ontology pool obtained by the mapping and assigns them to the query sequence. And at the same time, InterPro annotation allows to retrieve the domain and motif information in a sequence-wise manner. So this is how we started. That's what was our assembly table, our context table when we started in Blast2Go. And this is a table we ended up after running the workflow. So let's look at the colors here. So when we see blue colored context here, it means that the context is fully annotated here. When we see a red context with red background, it means that this particular context didn't find any blast hits. And the green ones you see here are those ones which we were able to map, but it was not annotated because with gene ontology terms because it didn't pass the annotation criteria, cutoffs, parameters cutoffs, which we will be using. And here I was using just the default parameters, and I will go a little bit more into how this all can be improved. And for each sequence, you also see here, here on this slide, it's a little bit in larger font here. So you can see the tags. So the tags will be assigned to each context if it was passed through InterPro annotation, if it obtained the blast hit, if it was mapped, and if it was annotated. So, and of course, these tables can be filtered however users chooses. So using tags or descriptions or IDs, etc. So any of these headers, any of these fields can be used to filter that particular table. The plant species with the most blast hits, which we obtained during our annotation, was Beta vulgaris. And this species is very well annotated species. It belongs to the same order as Cactaceous, order of Caryophyllales. And the pie chart on the right shows the proportions of context annotated. So annotated with gene ontology terms, this is a blue sector. Those which been just mapped but not annotated, the green sector, and the orange sector is those ones which been blast but have not been mapped, and the red sector are those contexts which didn't find any hits in NCBI. Yeah, one thing I forgot to mention is, of course, when you are doing blast, you are selecting your database. Of course, it was BLAST-X, and of course, we selected the plant proteins because we are working for annotation, because we are working with plant species, but it's under the user control what database to select in order to find your matches. Let's look closer into how annotation statistics can be improved. If we relax the mapping parameters for this particular orange sector, we would be able to move some of the sequences which obtained blast hits into this green sector, so they will be mapped. And then we can further relax annotation parameters and move some of these contexts which are in green sector to the blue area where we would have them to obtain also gene ontology terms. So everything you see here was done with default parameters, but they can be changed, and the annotation stats can be improved. So this is an example I'm giving here. So one of such contexts here in green, which was mapped but not annotated. So I can select this particular context and relax annotation cutoff parameters from number of 55 to 43, and then I will have this particular context now annotated with gene ontology terms, so it becomes blue. So it is as easy as this, so it's under the user control. And for some of contexts, if it needs to be done, it can be done. So let's also look into those contexts which don't have any blast hits. So those contexts which are here in the red sector, they can be analyzed using the tool called coding potential assessment tool in Blast2Go. So we can extract all those contexts, submit them to the tool, and we can get for them information if they are coding or not coding. Since we suspect that our species doesn't, well, we actually know that our species doesn't have a lot of closely related closely related species in gene bank, which would be very well studied and annotated. That's why some of those contexts we have, they are lineage specific contexts. So it would be hard for them to find, it would be probably impossible for them to find closely related hits in gene banks. That's why this coding information can be pretty useful. So by doing that, we were able to find those ones which have open reading frames. So in total, we identified 435 contexts which have potential of being coding transcripts using this tool. And and for this part, for conclusion of this part, I again showing you this chart, and this is probably a pretty typical chart for default annotation for the species which are non-model species without closely related, well-studied species available in GenBank. Okay, let's look what kind of functional annotations we got. For the biological process, we found that oxidation reduction is our most presented function in our assembly. For the cellular localization, it's integral component of the membrane, and for molecular function, ATP binding is a most presented function in our assembly. We also can look into the biological process combined chart and the software and see the most presented functional categories this way. And the same thing, we see here that metabolic process, cellular process, and some specific compound metabolic process also are highly presented in our assembly. And the same information can be visualized as a bar chart. Metabolic process is most presented, then followed by cellular process, and then by biological regulation. So this is a functional characterization of our entire assembly from developing, and entire assembly which we constructed was from both the developing root tip and fully differentiated root tip. Okay. Okay, let's look in the table which we created during this step of annotation, and this is a table which will be used in all subsequent analysis, because now we have for each of our contexts, we have hits coming from BLAST, we have gene ontology, we have interpro if they are available. So zooming in on particular rows, particular context of this annotation for enzymes, we will have enzyme codes assigned, enzyme names assigned. If this particular context is not an enzyme, we have those things open. Okay. And of course, for each of them, we will have a tag specifically assigned to them. So if they're annotated, they will have this blue tag, annotated tag. So that's basically that's not concludes actually the first part. So what I also wanted to tell you about that for many of the contexts, we will not get the gene ontology terms, but what Blast2Go will do, it will extract the best descriptor from the BLAST output. For example, for this particular quantic, we don't have gene ontology term, but from the blast heat, we will get the description. This description is stuck in here. And please note that if you are writing a simple blast parsers with extracting the best heat, in that case, I would get here uncharacterized protein as my heat, but Blast2Go parser will extract the most meaningful heat from the best heats obtained. So that's something which is used, and I use this also when I do not have gene ontology terms for my downstream research. So in summary here, for these first two steps, assembly was done, over 49,000 contigs we obtained, and we were able to assign some kind of functional description to over 30,000 contigs, and over 21,000 of transcripts now have gene ontology annotations. Okay, let's go to the next step where we wanted to identify those transcripts which are up or down regulated in the differentiated root tips. So transcript level quantification is processed in Blast2Go Cloud. And for the expression analysis, we used pairwise differential expression analysis, and this tool also available in Blast2Go. So now we are not pulling all our Illumina reads, which we had from both terminal and the terminal tissues. We are separating them into each library and counting how many reads from each library hits each of our contigs. So our input files here are our contig files, our contigs, etc. That is our reference. We're using tool which is called transcript level quantification, and we are counting reads. And the output from this process is a table, is a count table, and it contains information on the number of counts from each library assigned to each contig. Okay. And then this particular table will be passed into the tool, which is called pairwise differential expression analysis. And output from that tool will show you how many of our contigs upregulated or downregulated under certain parameters. So the parameters, our cutoffs, we are using here is false discovery rate less than 0.05, and this way we were able to identify 6,700 of contigs which are up and down regulated. And if we are using, and yeah, the other criteria we are using, that those transcripts should be up or down regulated at least twice, meaning log fold change more than one or log fold change less than minus one. Interestingly, we found that there are many more transcripts which are upregulated than downregulated. And we obtained over 5,000 transcripts which were upregulated during root differentiation and meristem exhaustion, and downregulated less than 1,500 contigs. Okay, so this is another chart which will be another small chart which will be created by the software. So how many contigs been used? How many contigs we inputted? How many contigs been used? Differentially expressed contigs, upregulated as green and downregulated as red. And the same information, the software also will output nice charts, nice visualization charts. And here you can clearly see how many of transcripts on this volcano plot, how many more transcripts are upregulated than downregulated. So upregulated in green, downregulated in red, and the same information in the AMA plot on the right. And of course, these cutoffs can be changed if user is choosing to use different log fold change. Okay, of course, these tables can be viewed, all the data can be viewed and filtered from the table too, from the expression data table too. And if you want to filter just for down-regulated genes, we simply can click on this tags header and select only down-regulated genes, and then we will end up with the same number as I always was telling you about, 1,483 down-regulated genes. And this extracted table, these sets of genes can be used for various downstream analysis. And of course, table, expression table and annotation table, they can be opened together and we can extract all these genes with annotations now. And you can see now that we have not only annotation tags, we also have expression tags. And here I selected just for upregulated. So you can see here this up tag for many of these genes. Okay. So if you look a little bit into biology now, because I was only doing technical part up to now, and there are a few interesting things we found that among down-regulated transcripts at the terminal development stage, we found genes annotated with such terms as the histones deacetylases, some peroxidases, hibberellin-related regulated proteins. So that was one set of annotation which was very interesting for the PI, because they involved this particular group in Mexico. They involved in hormonal regulation of the development. That's what they are studying, and they were very excited about it. And among the upregulated genes at the terminal developmental stage, there was an overrepresentation of various stress-related proteins, including this abscisic acid-induced proteins, abscisic acid stress-ripening proteins, abscisic acid receptors. So I mentioned stress, drought stress, and if you just want to take one important biological point out of this seminar, I would like to point to you that it would be that it's important to understand that as a genetic program to cope with drought stress in cactacea roots, this genetic program is triggered in any growth condition, because all the plants we grew for this experiment were grown in petri dishes. The plants did not experience any drought stress. The plants had enough water, enough of moisture to develop. So drought tolerance, drought resistance developmental program in cactacea initiates in any conditions. So without water deficit, it also will be initiated. So that's probably one biological insight I would like everyone to leave this seminar with. And the other point here is that there are many development differentially regulated transcripts which we found, and they are not annotated. So what we suspect here, and we did some follow-up research, that those transcripts most likely represent lineage-specific transcripts. And the other thing to remember here about annotation is that not everything published and public is available in GeneBank. We actually followed up with some authors which published the paper and they had publicly available data, but they never submitted them to GeneBank. So we went to them, we found that particular set of transcripts, and we were able to obtain, to annotate some additional transcripts using those data. Okay, and the last part. Now moving to the last part, the functional enrichment analysis part. And here what we are looking for, functional gene categories that are specifically enriched or depleted during primary root development in this particular cactus. So what we can do here And I was using a Fisher exact test, which is available on Blast2Go. So we want to compare the gene sets which are specifically downregulated or upregulated with the entire set of our entire transcriptome and see what is enriched and what is depleted during this development. So we are looking into downregulation, downregulated transcripts and upregulated transcripts, and looking into functions which are associated and which are associated with these genes, and which would be the most up or downregulated in terms of functions. So what we are finding here, that the functions associated with replication, chromosome segregation, cell division, cell organization, DNA repair are the most downregulated. And the functions which are associated with the transcriptions, sequence-specific binding, heme and iron binding, oxidation reduction process are those functions which are mostly upregulated in the differentiated route. So we can also use the same information as this graph. So for cellular component, integral component of membrane is the most presented. For molecular function, we see heme binding, we see peroxidase activity, iron binding, sequence-specific DNA binding, the most upregulated functions. And for the biological process, various stress-related processes are initiated here, such as oxidation reduction process, response to abscisic acid. So that's what is happening during transition from the developing root tip to fully differentiated root tip, when we do not have any active meristem here. And basically, this is very active tissue, but it's a fully differentiated tissue. So no cell division, no DNA replication is here. So the same information we can look for the functions in downregulated genes. So now we are looking for those functions which are go down during differentiation. And here, if we look into more zoomed in version of this graph, what we can see is that everything which is linked with DNA replication initiation, repair, chromosome segregation, microtubule based movements, so basically everything what is associated with cell division, DNA replication, chromosome segregation, everything is going down here. And there is no surprise in it, because we know that no cell divisions are happening right now here, just cell growth and very, very active physiological processes are happening here. Okay, so now into the summary of the functional changes. Basically, that's on this slide is everything I already said. So we found that over 5,000 genes induced, much less number of genes repressed. Those genes which are induced, they are related to stress, defense, oxidation reduction processes. Those genes which are repressed, they are genes which are involved in cell division. And for the conclusions for the entire project, what we were able to do here, that we started with no any available genomic resources. So we did not have any STs, we didn't have any reference genome. We wanted to study some physiological processes, but we didn't have the basic resources. So by doing this project, we were able to create these genomic resources by sequencing and assembling transcriptome. And then we used to Blast2Go to annotate this assembled transcriptome. And the program was very easy to use, and it allows for really high quality of annotation. So RNA-Seq analysis can also be can also be performed in Blast2Go cloud. And doing this, basically everything what is done in Blast2Go, everything what is computationally expensive is happening in Blast2Go cloud. And this eliminates the necessity of necessity for in-house computational resources. And to find the functional differences, we used Blast2Go enrichment tools. And this way we were able to identify functional changes during root development. So in the grand conclusion, basically I would like to say that Blast2Go allowed for easy and efficient process into the foundation resources which we completely lacked. And these resources are really necessary for subsequent functional analysis of the target genes. And I believe this is all from me. And now I'm passing the control back to Steve.
Great, thank you. Good, excellent. So thank you, Martha. I appreciate you touched on a lot of key points, but based on our audience mix of people who never heard about us or people who have heard about us and also current users, you really touched on some of the value props and the functions and features. Now, just to review that Martha went through, that if you guys want to even check out yourself, it's really the toolbox features are the key to the power of Blast2Go. As you can see, the workflow from characterization down to insights, they're very easy to use, powerful tables that you can drag and drop workflows. And with the addition of the genome browser, it really makes it a lot easier for you to, without having an advanced bioinformatics expertise, to analyze your data and get insights in a very user-friendly, customer-friendly UI. So let's go to the next slide, please. Great. So again, just to conclusion, I've got to thank everyone for joining us. If you have, again, any questions, we can answer them again more personally through an email. You can reach out to me or go to the Blast2Go website. We have there's a significant amount of information and videos that can address some of your issues, or feel free to either call or text me and we can arrange a time to actually spend more personal time with you to go over that. And again, thank you for taking time out of your day today to learn more about Blast2Go, and we appreciate that very much.